The traditional linear system of generating energy centrally and then distributing it to end users, often over very long distances, is changing rapidly. We're moving to a more decentralized, digital and greener system. Some industrial and corporate customers and even individuals are now also generators, feeding electricity back into what's being called the energy cloud. So what can we expect in the future? Well, let's meet two people from the global consultancy firm Navigant. Jan Willem Bode and Preeti Srivastav. I'm Sarah Lockett. Welcome to the Business Debate. Jan Willem and Preeti, welcome to the London Stock Exchange studios.
Thank you.
So, Jan Willem, what are some of the main changes that are really interesting? I suppose the most unusual one is the fact that corporate and industrial companies are actually generating their own energy now.
So we see two trends happening. On one hand, we see what we refer to as the energy cloud, which is effectively the energy transition going from a linear system to much more of a dynamic network of networks approach, where the end customer is much more central to the whole system than in the current way that the system operates. So with that in mind, you really see the role of corporates changing. They're much more of a dynamic player in the system. The second trend you see is the whole decarbonization trend. So you see, both from a top-down regulatory point of view as well as from a bottom-up customer point of view, a much stronger ask for low-carbon products, low-carbon services, general decrease of greenhouse gas emissions. And those two things are the main thing that impact on corporates.
And Preeti, why do corporate customers want to buy local energy? Why is it better? And can you even find out where your energy is generated?
We're all very familiar with the idea, the concept, and the benefits of buying local, right? For our food and for our services. But somehow this concept does not resonate very well when we speak about energy. And yet, local energy can help build energy security, develop infrastructure, create jobs. And when we think about renewable local energy, it has the advantage, or rather the halo effect, of helping with energy generation, energy storage, but also energy transportation, because the huge economic and environmental costs are usually associated with transportation. So the bottom line is, if we're looking at local renewable energy, it can make a difference at the community level, but also at the national and international level.
And Jan Willem, what can we learn from the energy markets that are really getting this right?
I think what we can really learn there is that you have to build a system that is truly dynamic, truly interactive, where you do put that end customer first, and they do have a different role to play. So rather than just being, you know, passive consumers, they actually play a role in the system to keep it stable, to generate electricity. I think those are the main lessons to learn.
And Preeti, how does how we get and store our energy, how does that help in the fight against climate change?
According to the Paris Agreement, if we all want to stay within our planetary boundaries, the global average temperature increase cannot be more than 1.5 or 2 degrees Celsius. And currently, the energy and transportation sector contributes for more than half of the carbon emissions globally. So if we do want to meet our climate ambitions and goals, we have to get them on board. And secondly, when we speak about clean, mobile, intelligent systems in terms of energy, we must look at them in the context of long-term climate risks, in the context of scarcity of supply. Companies are actually reducing their resource consumption because of the principles of circular economy and other possibilities. So the overall global material flow is changing, the global energy flow is changing, and therefore it's important for companies to be prepared to adapt to that. And in terms of climate change, if we do want to reduce our climate impact, we have to move away from a centralized fossil fuel-based energy system.
And Jan Willem, what other angles are available to corporates as they transition to optimize their processes and also to shift their investments?
Yeah, I think one of the key things is that very often energy transition is associated with additional costs. Whereas actually the nice thing about those two trends of decarbonization and energy transition is that they actually go hand in hand at the moment, purely because there is a cost benefit in a lot of cases. So from a corporate point of view, signing a long-term power purchase agreement from a local green electricity plant is not just the right thing to do from an environment point of view, but can very well also be the right thing to do from a financial point of view. The key thing is that corporates need to change the way they think. Rather than signing a 2-year contract to buy their electricity, they need to be able to sign longer term contracts. But it does make their business more resilient.
And how should organisations work with their supply chain to make sure that their greenhouse gas emissions are reducing down the line?
What you see right now is there needs to be more of an interactive relationship with your supply chain. It's different, of course, if you're a very big purchaser and you can just tell your supply chain what to do from a greenhouse gas emissions point of view. But if you're not in that position, then you do need to engage with your supply chain in a different way than is traditionally the case. You really need to work with your supply chain. The nice thing about it is, though, that you actually end up having longer term relationships with your supplier and a much more resilient supply chain than is currently the case.
And Preeti, companies are increasingly storing their own electricity. Now, why does it make sense for them to do that? Because it's not their core business, is it?
It's not. And Sarah, to be honest, I think there is a universal memo for all the CEOs who do not consider themselves to be in the energy business. Because you may not be in the power business today, but it is extremely likely that you will be in it by tomorrow. And this is considering companies like Apple, Coca-Cola, Walmart, IKEA. When we think of these companies, we don't think of them as energy companies. And yet, almost all of these companies are investing heavily in renewable energy. And of course, they're the perfect candidate because they have a large energy consumption, they have variable power usage, and they have the ability to buy and sell energy and energy products globally. But at the same time, almost, I would say, majority of these companies are doing so or are looking at renewable energy, not just to reduce their carbon emissions, but also because they want to look at additional revenue streams and reduce costs and risk, of course.
Really interesting. On that note, thank you very much, both of you.
Thank you.
And remember, that's all we've got time for. But join us next time when we'll be hearing from more global thought leaders. From me, though, Sarah Lockett at the London Stock Exchange Studios, it's goodbye and thanks for watching.